here we're going to look at how to find the component form of a vector. And here I have a vector v, and you can see the starting point or the tail, and you can see the head is b. So how do we find the component form? To find the component form, we just need to take the coordinates given. So I'm going to write the coordinates of a, and the coordinates of a are, so the coordinates of a are 1, 2, and the coordinates of b are 2, 2, 5. And then what I'm going to do with these coordinates, I'm just going to take, let me label them as x1, y1, x2, y2. That way we can get a general formula we can use for any example. And to find the component form, the component form is written using this symbol here. So it's going to be x2 minus x1 and then y2 minus y1. And this is going to be 2 minus 1 comma 5 minus 2. So we get 1, 3. So using the head and tail, we have been able to come up with the component form of a vector. And why do I need the component form? I need the component form because when I graph the component form, it's going to correspond with this definition. It describes the change in the x and y values. When I ever see a vector in component form, immediately I'm able to know the direction along the x-axis and the y, and the direction along the y-axis. For example, if I graph this vector, I'm going to start at 0 at the origin. I graph at the origin and I'm going to go 1 to the right. So I'm going to go 1 to the right, and then I'm going to go 3 steps up. So this is going to be the end point. So I just connect, and this is the vector v. Now in standard form, this is standard form. See, whenever I see a vector in component form, I know it is starting at the origin. But remember, a vector could start anywhere. It could move this vector v anywhere. You can see this vector v is the same vector as this one. I could move it to any location. It's just that when I write it in component form, it's easier to compare it because I know what it means instead of having points just anywhere.